following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
It's 10 p.m. Do you know where your children are?
Let me know.
Oh, frog and money, Gordon, he did ride Crambo.
I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill.
Green Acres is the place.
And that's Uncle Joe, he's a moving kind of slow at the junction.
Here we come, walk down the street.
Boy, the way Glenn walked away.
Who is on first?
Why are you asking me for? I don't know.
Now, wait a minute.
I'm asking you who's on first.
That's his name.
Well, go ahead and tell me.
Who?
The guy on first.
That's it. That's his name.
Well, you said that. I ain't asked you nothing.
You did?
You know the guy's name on first base?
Sure.
Tell me the guy's name on first base.
Who?
Hey, what's up, everybody? It's your boy, Jonathan McReynolds, and you are now listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show. It's my guy.
Hello, this is Ed Showers talking, and you are now listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Let's go.
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
A Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
A Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
A Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
A Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show, co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in where we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk.
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
Calling all musicians, new artists, singers, composers, poets, and producers. Grab a pen and some paper and listen up. It seems your career is on a treadmill, huh? Got some tips for you. So don't touch that dial. It's Music Business Night right here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Everybody, so welcome to the Sir Walter Jones Show. I'm
here.
It is Wednesday. Wednesday. Music Business Day. Man, we sit around the mic and talk about the music business, music
industry. Mike. You know what day it is?
yep. It's hump day. I tell you, I'm so excited because we got another great show today. I have launched a Black Father's Day Challenge this month. All month, y'all, leading up to Father's Day and beyond. I wish you can just continue it if you can. Will you please continue it? That'd be great. A Black Father's Day Challenge to all of you ladies out there, especially you ladies, because I want the brothers to do it as well. As you post on Facebook all of the wonderful things that you have to say about black men, because we're not hearing any of it.
And
every time we turn on the TV, we see black men being toe up from the floor up from police, and then we turn on Fox News, and there y'all are again dogging us, and then we look on Facebook, and there y'all are dogging us. And then we go to school, look at these little girls threatening these little boys with their fists, and then the boys, bam, knock them out.
And we be villainized because we do what's natural.
Because we do what's natural to us. So we're just tired. We have no encouragement whatsoever. So this month, starting today, is a music business show, so we'll be able to do some things here to inspire the brothers out there. We're talking about musical brothers. The musical brothers, y'all, we got three today, and we're going to continue this for the rest of the month. My choice today is, of course, from the Isley Brothers, and we've got the great brother. The great brothers Johnson, and we've got the Jackson 5 as well as the Jacksons. Yes. We call the Jackson 5, but because that's what they was, and then they became the Jacksons after that.
So what were they before they were survived?
Well, they were just a couple guys being beat up by their father.
Oh.
Saying, put that guitar down.
The abused few.
the abused few. You're wrong for that. You know that,
okay.
Right?
Okay. Joe ain't gonna whoop me.
Yeah, Joe. Joe too old. He can't chase me now. He can't run. Hey, you know, we're talking about music. There's a lot of there's different genres of music out there. We got alternative, blues, classical music, country, dance and easy listening. We got electronic, European. We got hip hop, rap. They can usually go together. We got indie pop, inspirational, which includes gospel, of course. Asian pop. They call it J pop or K pop.
Okay.
We got jazz, Latin music, New Age, opera, pop or popular music, R&B and soul. They go together. Reggae, rock, singer-songwriter, includes folk music, and of course world music, which includes beats. All those genres have subgenres to them. And today we're going to just figure out the R&B and the soul portion of the genres of music by starting with the Isley Brothers, an American musical group originally from Cincinnati, Ohio. Originally a vocal trio consisting of brothers O'Kelly Isley Jr., Rudolph Isley, and Ronald Isley. And the group has been cited as having enjoyed one of the longest, most influential, and most diverse careers in the pantheon of music, popular music.
Pantheon.
Mm-hmm.
Big word.
Absolutely. Alongside of fourth brother, Vernon. The group originally performed gospel music until Vernon's death a few years after its original, their forming. And after moving to New York City. The group had modest chart success during their early years, first coming to prominence in 1959 with this great hit here I'm going to play here. Go to number one, Britney, written by the three brothers, initially a modest charted single. The song eventually sold over 1 million copies. Here it is, y'all. Song called Shout.
You know you make me wanna shout.
The words.
Shout.
Don't forget to say yeah. Say you will. Say it right now, baby. Say you will. Come on. Say you will. Say that you will.
Listen to Ron in the background on top. I love this part, right? Oh, no, when they break it down.
You boys sing.
Right here.
I want you to know.
Yeah. Look at that B3 in the background. Just pulls it on in there.
This was the White Sox theme song when they won the World Series. Angela Garrett says, I heard them sing that in church, of course. Church classic shout. Actually, this is, it was written by the Isley Brothers. It was a call and response answer to Jackie Wilson, his lonely teardrop. Go to number two, Brittany, which they would occasionally cover in a live performance. This is the great Jackie Wilson. You hear the similarity, but slow down just a little bit. Lonely Teardrops, 1958.
My heart is crying, crying. Lonely Teardrops. My blue ever tried.
Same song.
Lonely Teardrops.
Now, Shout has woven itself into an iconic American media, such as the dance song, in which people progressively crouch down to the dance floor as the song gets quieter. For example, at the end of the third quarter of an Oregon Ducks game at Altman Stadium, in recognition of National Lampoon's Animal House, being filmed at the University of Oregon, the crowd traditionally dances to the song. A parody of the song has been adopted to victory music and through 1987 version recorded by Scott Kemper, an ongoing promotional theme of the NFL Buffalo Bills. The song was also a duo used in several Elmo toys, one of which was pulled off the market due to many people hearing beat up Elmo and shout, rip his fur out and shout, when it was supposed to be like Elmo and shout, shake your fur out and shout. The song was featured heavily in Animal House, as performed by Otis Day and the Knights, fronted by character actor Dwayne Jesse of Otis. The song is currently the Winnipeg Jets' goal song. They played at the home games of the Chicago White Sox, as Bernie says, and the Chicago Bulls. We're going to number two. Number three, Brittany. This is Isley Brothers' song called Lay, Lady, Lay, 1971, off of the album called Giving It Back. Giving It Back.
They crossed over a whole lot and have been covered by so many.
Lay, lady, lay.
When I listen to them, they did it first. Wow.
Yes.
Lay, lady, lay. Lay across my big grass bed.
Lay, lady, lay.
Lay across my big
lay. The smooth, soft sound of that era, 1971. The singer-songwriter era. You were 9 years old, Preacher? Yeah, you was that old?
Right.
Good Lord.
I wasn't born.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah, let's go to number four, Brittany. This is Isley Brothers, Between Those Sheets. No More Sheets, y'all.
That's one of my favorites.
22nd album released by Isley Brothers on their T-Neck imprint, April 24, 1983. The album is notable for the title track and the follow-up ballad, Choose a Lover.
You skipping something now.
Between the Sheets.
Because one of them gospel music doesn't copy. Drifted on the memory.
Hey girl, ain't no mystery.
That is so classic.
Very classic.
Nobody sounds like this.
Nope. Quiet Storm funk song. call it.
Y'all say Luther's got the baby making music. Nah. Ron Isley.
Songwriting credit was shared with all six bandmates, though only Marvin and Ernie wrote the song. That was the trend back then. That time. That's just the way it was.
That's so all people can get a part of that royalty.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Jazz band 4Play recorded a hit cover version of a song on 1992 with Chaka Khan as the vocalist. All right. I don't want to get y'all all excited, ladies, so we're moving on here. I was going to number 4 here. Uh-oh. I'm sorry to say, but here's another one. Number 5, I'm sorry. This is Sensuality, Part 1 and 2 from the Heat Is On album, 1975. This is right here. Takes
that
me back.
That's ahead of its time.
Yeah, show up.
I remember this too.
Man, yes. It's what that bass does subtly. Billy, oh, when it does that, it lets you know he's focused. Right there.
Yes.
Here I lay. Yeah. So I'm not going to show what you did. I'm not going to show
right here, right here, right here, right there.
Yes, sir. There it is. There it is. There it is. It's all about the bass in this song.
The subtlety.
And the subtlety of the yes. The subtlety. Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. That means orgasmic things are happening within his mind. Within his mind.
Yeah, he's somewhere.
Yeah, he's somewhere. Yeah. You get that, Minister Richardson.
Woo! And he should have been a secret guard.
Yeah.
That's true. Instead of Al, be sure. Hush it up.
Better hush that up. We're going to number 6, Brittany, before Alvin get too much in trouble. Here's an Isley Brothers hit. This one here is called Voyage to Atlantis. Go For Your Guns is the 15th album by the Isley Brothers. April 16, 1977 on their T-Neck album. It was also the band's 5th album to be distributed by their deal with Epic Records, y'all. Voyage to Atlantis.
Man. To have such massive hits but not ever be like number one.
Mm-hmm.
It's not political.
Yeah.
He was always a gentleman. He called her lady all the time. Couldn't forget her name that way.
Another So smooth. And he loves you, that echo in his mixes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only thing that dates their sound.
Dates the sound, sure. Mix. Yes. We're going to number 7 here. Talking about ladies, they pretty much sang to all ladies on every album. This one here is called Who's That Lady, by the way. 1973 R&B soul hit by these guys on T-Neck Imprints. One of the group's most well-known was originally performed by the group's nearly a decade before 1964, Who's That Lady? Inspired by the Impressions. After signing with Epic Records 1973, the eldest member of the group, old Kelly Isley, Rudolph Isley, and Ronald Isley, had included younger singer guitarist Ernie Isley, bassist Marvin Isley, and keyboardist Chris Jasper.
They were a rough-looking crew of brothers, though, man.
Yeah, they were.
You look at them guys like, man, no, I will not get into a fight with them. O'Kelly, especially.
O'Kelly.
Like he was old killer.
And this song was on a commercial.
Several.
Yeah. She just do what I say. I'll give her anything. Ladies, y'all need to hear that. Yeah, whatever you... Okay, within reason, all right? I'm sorry. I'm sorry to be so dogmatic about that. But within reason, you just do what I say. Within reason. I'll give you everything. Hey, we're going to number 8. This song here says, hey, man, don't say goodnight. Just don't say it. 1980 Quiet Storm song by these guys was released as an answer to a Teddy Pendergrass hit, Turn Off the Lights. Was an ode to love song by Ronald Isley, who begs his lady in a trademark falsetto to give him her love, stating, if people say that love is for the giving, so let me love you, girl.
I love that line.
Let me love you, girl.
They classic, all about the song, not necessarily about the music. When you listen to band play, you listen to the drummer. He is as simple as can be. Everything is simple. Everything goes for the song, and the lyric, and the singer. Now the complexity comes in their progressions. Because they sound simple, but they're hard how they flow. And then they're so consistent. But it don't sound like one. Another key change.
It's time for love.
Key change.
This ain't the breakup song, Alan.
No, I'm just saying for those listening that it ain't always gotta be elaborate to be exotic. And to be challenging or to be fun. Because this really sounds simple. Until you start playing.
The simple songs makes the most exotic songs.
Yeah.
The most romantic.
It requires the most discipline, too.
It does require the most discipline.
Because you ain't heard, you haven't even heard a glissando from the keyboard player.
No glissando, no runs.
He's just sitting there, probably half asleep.
Yeah, he knocked out. We'll call number 9. This is a quintessential tagline for many preachers out there who tell y'all stay away from sin. It's Your Thing. It's a funk single. Released
this
1969.
Been all over commercials too.
Oh, absolutely.
Weight Watchers.
Yes.
It's your thing. Do what you wanna do.
And I didn't know this was them in a long time.
I can't tell you who to talk to.
Is this the answer to Aretha's Respect?
Thing. Right, exactly.
I'm just asking, give us that kind of vibe.
Oh, it does have that vibe, yeah.
Yeah. You get tired too.
You get tired, yeah.
Just as bad as I do. Makes me know I'm first now. You get your thing.
Then guitars are cutting up though.
The funk. The backboard, do the walk.
This funk anthem was an artistic response to Motown chief Berry Gordy. Him demanding hold on his artist after the Isleys left the label in 1968.
Oh, I didn't know they were Motown artists.
Yeah.
Wow.
The lyrics have a chorus, which also serve as two, as a first verse run. It's Your Thing, do what you want to do. I can tell you who to talk to. I can't tell you, that is. The song is ranked number 420 on the Rolling Stone magazine list of 500 greatest songs of all time.
by Ronald O'Kelly and Rudolph. Yeah. We're going to number 10. This is a groovy thing right here. Groove With You. From Slow Down is the 16th album released by the Isley Brothers on the T-Neck Imprint Albums, April 22, 1978. It was a very good year.
That's biblical.
Yeah.
What's biblical? I read it, but I don't know. Does it tell anything about Ron Isley being accredited to the discovery of Kelly Price?
Probably so.
Because he heard it's like that girl got to do something.
Wow.
I think she's on his, he's on her freshman project.
That's Groove With You. Number 11, Brittany, this is Caravan.
Oh, yeah.
This is Isley, Jasper Isley, okay?
Yeah,
the spinoff there. By Ernie, Chris, Jasper, and Marvin. It's 1985 R&B hit originally recorded by Isley, Jasper Isley, the second half of the Isley Brothers 3.3 lineup in 1970s. After breaking away from the legendary group, the group, notably Chris Jasper, wrote and produced this single, which was Jasper's interpretation in intending to reach audiences by presenting Christian beliefs in his music. The song became the trio's biggest hit, going to number one on the Billboard charts and 51 on the Billboard charts in 1985.
I remember this, we was in high school.
Ronald, like many siblings, began his career in church. He began singing at the age of three, winning a $25 war bond for singing at the spiritual contest at the Union Baptist Church, y'all. At the Riga Theater. In 1993, he married producer, composer, singer Angela Winbush.
Yeah, I remember that.
In Los Angeles, California. They quietly divorced in 2002. When Winbush received chemotherapy following her ovarian cancer diagnosis, Isley was by her side, giving her his support in her recovery. He has older children with various women, including daughters Tawana and Trenisha. In 2004, while in London, Isley suffered a mild stroke, which halted Isley Brothers' tour there. In September 2005, Isley made headlines when he married background singer Candy Johnson of the duo's J.S. Johnson sisters, who is 35 years old. His junior. Their son, Ronald Isley Jr., was born in 2007. In 2007, it was reported Isley had kidney problems. He still lives in St. Louis. He has some tax evasion problems, but I ain't gonna talk about that right now.
I'm gonna kick Wesley.
I'm on. No, you're not. Don't go there. All right, y'all. We made it in 30 minutes. 11 songs from the Isley Brothers. Thank you, guys. You positive brothers for giving us such wonderful music there. There's so many others I could play.
That's the place I'd rather
be. Yeah, we sure can do that.
The
but we're going to the great Brother Johnson right now. I'm going to see if I can find the demo here because demo. Bio. The demo bio.
Demo bio.
Demobable. The Brother Johnson were American funk and R&B band consisting of American musicians and brothers George, that's Lightning Licks, and Louis E. Johnson, Thunder Thumbs. They achieved their greatest success from the mid-1970s to early 80s with the three singles topping the R&B chart. I'm going to play those in a minute here. But the formation of guitarist vocalist George and bassist vocalist Louis formed the band Johnson 3+1. With older brother Tommy and their cousin Alex Weir while attending school in Los Angeles. Y'all know what that place is? Big place, by the
That's
way.
The Big West
Side. When they became professionals, the band backed such touring R&B acts as Bobby Womack. Bobby! And the Supremes. George and Louis Johnson later joined Billy Preston's band and wrote music in my life and the kids and me for him before leaving his group in 1973. In 1976, the brothers covered the Beatles song Hey Jude for the ephemeral musical documentary All This and War, World War II. Quincy Jones hired them to play on his LP Mellow Madness and recorded four of their songs, including Is It Love That We're Missing and Just a Taste of Me. After touring with various artists, including Bobby Womack and Preston, they were hired by Quincy Jones for a tour in Japan and produced their debut album. So, yeah, we're going to do some of the Johnson's greatest hits for me. These are some of my favorites, indeed. Let's see what we're going to start with. We're going to start with number 12, the Brother Johnson. This song here is huge. It's not Kirk Franklin, y'all. It's their rendition of Stomp. Brother Johnson from their fourth album, Light Up the Life. Light Up the Night, that is, in the early 1980s. Reached number one dance single chart, reached number one on the R&B singles chart, peaked at number seven on the Billboard. It was the biggest success in the UK. Greg Fillinganes on keyboard synthesizer, Rod Temperton on electric piano. Stomp!
That's a power band. That's the off-the-wall band, actually.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, you hear the sound. My Anthony Harmon tribute.
Yeah, Anthony Harmon. Yeah, that's him. And it's that interlude, that funk interlude. I'm delayed. Okay.
Way back in
I was trying to see if I get to that middle where he get the thumping. Harmon.
Yeah.
Okay, that's something, y'all. Let's go to this great, huge, huge hit. It's a song written by and composed by Shuggy Otis, best known by the version recorded by Brothers Johnson and Quincy Jones. Produced, Otis recorded in 1971 album Freedom Flight. Mm-hmm. George Johnson of the Brothers Johnson was dating one of Otis' cousins when he came across the album Freedom Flight. They recorded this Strawberry Letter 23 in 1977 album right on time. Produced by Quincy Jones, and the album went platinum, y'all. They recorded the song in a funkier, more dance-oriented vein than the original Otis version.
Hello, my love, I heard a kiss from you. Red magic,
it's like you're in a swing.
All through the morning rain again.
I don't know, I have these weird images that I use as mnemonic devices to help me with songs. Especially when they just... I think I grew up in this era and I'm stuck there musically.
Yeah, I am too.
Because there's new stuff that they play, I can do it, but I don't think it. I think this.
Is it cool? If you arrive and don't see me, I'm gonna be with my baby.
Terry Owens, how you doing, man? Good to see you. This song was heard briefly in the Quentin Tarantino's Pulp Fiction. It's also heard in Jackie Brown, the film Jackie Brown. 6 Feet Under TV series is heard in Nip Tuck, Kellogg Special K, Red Berry cereal, and the film Munich. DJ Quick uses a sample of it. Silk uses it. And just a host of people just love
it. I love that Glockenspiel in the background.
And Glockenspiel. You know what?
Sounds like a circus.
Yeah, it does.
Like a merry-go-round. I never would have thought to use that.
No, me either. Yeah.
How many guitar players are trying to do this?
Yo, come on, man. Johnson, he says, say my name, Dave. Dave Johnson's on the name. Hey, we're going to I'll Be Good to You. 1976 hit song by R&B duo. George Johnson, one of the two Johnson brothers in the band, wrote the song after deciding to commit to a relationship with one woman, y'all, one woman, instead of dating several at a time. He was recording a demo to the song. Family friend Sonora Sam came by and added some lyrics. Yes, sir, producer Quincy Jones heard the song and said, let's do it. let's see, 1989, it became a number one R&B hit again with Chaka Khan and Ray Charles doing the lead vocals, Quincy Jones' Back on the Block album. It went to number 18 on the Billboard Hot 100. I'll Be Good to You. Also topped American Dance Chart 1990. This was Ray Charles' first number one R&B hit in 24 years. I'll Be Good to You. That ain't before your time, Terry. Stop playing, man. It's a sin alive, Terry Owens. Come on now, you know good well you was in that band. Hey, we're going to, let's see, la 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 la. Number 15. This is from the Lookout Project. Number one album, 1976. Hello. Get the funk on my face.
Woo. Well, I remember everybody saying that. I got slapped this song.
What you say, boy? What you say?
I was singing, my boy. I was singing. You don't like my music, you ain't got to use it.
See that? I didn't know what they were saying. And all this time, I was still trying to figure out what they say. See, they got all mixed up. I heard the drum.
Yep. He said, you ain't even right there. You ain't even got to try to sing. That's why Ella Kemper Gee says this got a lot of folks jumped on. You make me want to wiggle.
Is this gospel music?
Yeah, well, no. Johnny Ross, I got a song that I'm going to feature for him. That's tomorrow. I gave you the wrong day, John. We're featuring tomorrow on Theology Thursday. Your song featured tomorrow. Johnny Ross's hit song tomorrow. Theology Thursday with Elder Rodney Jones. We're talking about forgiveness. Don't go nowhere. Johnny Ross. Tomorrow. 17, Brittany. This is Brother Johnson's song called Tomorrow. A classic instrumental from 1976 from the album entitled Lookout for Number One. Beautiful instrumental.
Oh, yes.
And it sounds familiar because Quincy Jones picked it back up. It's a reprise.
Now, I didn't know they did this first.
I didn't know it either.
Wow.
Quincy Jones did it in 1990, Back on the Block album. Tevin Campbell, he ain't a little boy now. He grown up now. And Quincy produced this one as well. So he just went back on the block.
And just put some words on it. Mm-hmm. Maybe that's what back on the block means.
Come on now.
Snatch from here, snatch from there.
Pretty much. She just went back on the block.
Wow. To show you how timeless some music is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because this is decades prior.
Yes, it is. I had no idea it was Brother Johnson.
Wow. I like this better.
Yeah.
Right there, see there?
Mm-hmm.
It gets lost under Tevin's voice.
Under his voice?
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, the uniqueness of all this is Tevin sounded like young Michael.
Yes.
So Quincy was a genius.
Sure.
To take that youthful sound, that refreshing sound, and make a hit out of it.
Mm-hmm.
With such a positive song.
Positive song.
It was a very positive song because
sure.
Everybody was singing it for graduation.
They were.
Every 8th grade graduation did that song.
You're right. You're sure right. And they all tried to find a little Tevin.
Yeah.
To sing with him.
Well, they had all the kids singing.
Mm-hmm. Vern Scott says, I love instrumental music. Well, me and Alvin do too. We're musicians. We're doing an instrumental show coming up real soon. Some of the top instrumental songs that you recognize coming up in another couple weeks. My. Timothy Mills, how you doing, man? Welcome to the show. Dave Johnson say, play Rance Allen tomorrow. And no needing crying now, that's it.
Ain't no need of crying.
No, that ain't tomorrow, Dave. It ain't a music show tomorrow, Dave. I'm sorry, man.
Keep going back. That's all, because a lot of people knew about that song.
Yeah, I see.
I love that song.
Maybe I'll do an outro of that song. I don't know. Maybe, Dave, if you come back tomorrow, maybe I'll do it for you. Only for you, though. This last one here from the Brothers Johnson is called Blam. That's it. That's all it's called. Blam!
Wow. What an intro.
Earth, Wind, and Fire.
You hear all the 70s and 80s music right there, because they were the session. They were the session music.
They were the session. That's right.
That's Jackson's all day.
Yeah, sure is.
Sounds like Edwin Hawkins.
Yeah, it does. You know that?
Singing.
Now you see the bass guitar and the lead guitar.
Playing the same
line. Doing the same. Yes, sir, man. Come on now. This is EWF. Right?
Yeah. Sound like Walter. Edwin or Andre done flipped the song.
Flip, yep. You're right. I know just what I like, and I like what I see. I'm gonna get you up.
Wow.
The Chicago right there, horn. Power.
Yes. Yeah, look, Chicago horn.
Yes, sir. That's funky, baby. That's funky. I hear some Blue Eyed Soul in there, too.
Oh, yeah. This song just is like an air fresh.
Song written by David Foster, of course. Quincy Jones.
That explains the EWF sound. David,
yes, sir. Louis Johnson. Tom Baylor. Larry Carlton on guitar.
Really?
Steve Kahn. Yes. Yes, sir. Larry Carlton. Right now. That funky day, man, get the funk out my face. That's just funky. That's that nasty, dirty funk.
Yeah, it's stinky draw.
That's funk. That wash that's between that's your
toes.
Toes funk.
That's that jam underneath the bra.
That's the funk that's going to funk you up.
Woo!
Just got the room just funk.
That's that get the Febreze funk.
Get the Febreze funk.
Flies on the stage funk.
wow, wow, wow.
That makes James Brown articulate. What's that smell?
Maceo! Give me the spray. I'm gonna get ya. Yeah, yeah. In 2002, besides the brothers' brief appearance in Japan in 1994 and George Guest's appearance at the Graham's Central Station concert in Japan, including a release, a double CD, the duo launched an expanded U.S. tour in 2002, which got positive wide exposure. It was visited by many fans and various artists in the entertainment business, along with the website and discussion forum. Online visitors could share their experience of the shows by wandering through the land of ladies and reliving Funkadelic's heyday. A few years later, a combi release of live CD plus DVD was released under the name Strawberry Letter 23 Live. Mm. Until recently, the brothers have been doing performances on their own. In 2006, Lewis gave a duo show with a drummer on a Poetry in Motion One festival in Maryland. And in 2007, George performed with his own band at a Detroit festival, including a persona called Sir Knowles. Okay, we know Sir Knowles. Sir Knowles was right next door. He did the Pinnell Johnson show.
Yes,
I met Sir Knowles and told him, man, your nose got shorter.
Mm-hmm.
These days, George performs with a special band and initiative of Michael Henderson that includes Dinah Howard, Sherelle, Ray Parker Jr., and others. Lewis Johnson died May 21, 2015. No cause of death was given. Shocked the musical industry, but oh boy. Two brothers gave us wonderful legacy.
Yes.
Thank you, Brother Johnson, for the music that you gave us. We are just, we're better musicians today because of you.
Definitely.
Absolutely. All right, y'all. We're going to the last group for the night. These guys right here, man, what can you possibly say about these dudes, all right?
Tone deaf.
Yeah.
Fast feet.
You name it. They everything you can think of. And more.
They don't get older.
Mm-mm. No. Although they look tend to change with the time or how expensive the surgery can be. Yeah. Depends.
Tito the only one.
It all depends.
And Marlon, they the only one with their original noses.
Yeah, with their original noses, right. Right. But as far as
Jermaine, he looked like Super Sales now.
Jermaine. I don't know what's going on with
Jermaine.
Looks
like Tin Man.
Oh my gosh. I just can't put my finger on it.
Nah, I wouldn't touch it either. I would not touch it either. Everything might fall apart.
Nope, he might be listening. Sorry, Jermaine. That's
you're the better singer now. I give it to you now.
He is the better singer. Jermaine
Baby,
Jackson.
Let's go out tonight.
Is the better singer. And yep, Let's Get Serious. And
under-celebrated for his bass player.
For his bass player. That's so true. Yeah. Yeah, that is true. I was looking. I don't know what everything's trying to lock up on me, but there it is. Okay. It's giving me a headache. I'm trying. Good old Wi-Fi. Slowing things down for me, you know. I don't. La-da-dee, la-da-da. We're going to get there in a minute.
La-da-dee, la-da-da.
La-da-dee, la-da-da. The Jacksons, the Jackson 5, and they got several names. The Jackson 5, or mm-hmm. Jackson 5, mm-hmm. and the Jacksons mm-hmm. in later years. American pop music group formed in 1963 under the name the Jackson Brothers. Our founding members, Jackie, Tito, Jermaine, Marlon, and Michael.
Sigmund.
Mm-hmm. Freud.
No, would, that's Jackie's name.
I'm sure.
Sigmund.
Yes. Would join 1 year later after participating. See, now you asked who were the original members.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Michael joined 1 year later. After participating in talent shows.
It was the original name.
Yeah, right. They played the children's circuit, of course. We all did. Because, you know, church got a children's circuit.
Oh, definitely.
We definitely. My Jones brothers, my father had us in the children's circuit.
Well, it's a salami church.
The fried chicken circuit. They entered the professional music scene in 1967, signing with Steeltown Records and releasing 10 singles. In 1969, they left Steeltown Records in order to sign with the great Motown. Dr. Five is one of the first groups of black American performers to obtain a crossover following preceding by the Supremes, the Four Tops, and the Temptations, scoring 17 top 40 singles on the Hot 100. After continuing with further hits such as Never Can Say Goodbye and Dancing Machine, most of the groups, with the exception of Jermaine, left Motown for Epic Records. Man, everybody was jumping on Epic back then.
Epic
time.
Was bad.
Epic was epic.
Epic was the Walmart of yes, the record
labels
back then.
It sure
the
was. 1975, with the brother Randy taking Jermaine's place, they released five albums in 1976 and 1981, including the hits albums, I remember Destiny was huge, and Triumph.
Boom, 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 boom.
Quite a few of those things, man.
Dancing, dancing, dancing.
He's a dancer, man.
Yeah, say what you will about Joe Jackson. He gave us these boys, and these boys took us through an experience that
and
we'll
he
never
said,
forget.
Y'all can say what you want. Every last one of them millionaires.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's so true. He beat them rich.
You know what? That's a different take for real.
That is a different take, Doc.
Hit me again.
Hit me again.
Hit me again. Okay, Joseph, I'll have another.
This is number 19, ABC's 1970 number one hit by Jackson 5, American Bandstand, first hit, February 21st.
There's a lot to be said for Jermaine to do all that moving.
Yeah. ABC knocked Beatles, Let It Be off the charts. Off the charts, Billboard's Hot 100 in 1970, number one on the soul single chart for 4 weeks. It was written with the same design as their first 1970s hit, I Want You Back. It's a signature song for the Jacks.
Bassline is a skill.
Yes, sir. We're going to a break here, y'all. We're going to do some news and come back with the great Jackson 5. So on the Jones Show.
Show is paid program and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Hey you, singers, musicians, writers, and producers. Feel like your career is on a treadmill? Tune in to the Sir Walter Jones Show, and we have tips or the solution for you.
You. I treated you bad.
Who's Loving You by the great Jackson 5. I love Michael singing in the background there. Who's Loving You? Got that little jazzy thing going on there. Soul.
What happened to his soul? Like he lost it.
Yeah, well, he gone now, so he don't have it anymore. Album Cicada. This is Diana Ross Presents the Jackson 5. This is 1969. This song was written by Smokey Robinson, who did it first, of course, with the
Miracles.
The Miracles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then Michael took it, and I remember him singing it on the, I think it was.
Should have been Ed Sullivan.
Ed Sullivan. He was walking down the street, you know, and he had his little jacket on his side.
Yeah, see, that was one of the first music videos.
Yeah, absolutely. Terry, who says, no news is good news. That's right, Preacher. No news is good news, because I can't get it up on my iPad. Got to empty it out tonight.
Yeah,
so,
Preacher's.
Yeah. Terry, we saying there, that's the only kid I know that's.
Sung a blues song.
And killed it. Yeah. That's right. Yeah, he did.
That was straight blues.
Yeah, he
did. That was Smokey Robinson.
He did. He did it.
Smokey couldn't have done it like that.
Mm-hmm. Smokey did it first, though.
But he didn't do it like that.
Not like that.
No, he admitted that. He said, I heard this little 10-year-old boy singing my song better than
amazing.
Me.
Amazing. Just amazing. We're going to the Love You Save. Stop. Mm-hmm. ABC, Project 97 by the Corporation. The Corporation wrote this. Y'all know who the Corporation is? The Corporation wrote many of these songs. Corporation's Barry Gordy, Freddie Perren, Alfonso Mizell, and Deke Richards. You know, they wrote everything.
Oh, yeah.
The Love You Say.
These songs they wrote, they couldn't nobody do nothing else with. Oh. You cannot hear the Temptations, dude. Can't hear the Marvelettes, dude. Stevie wasn't going to do it. Always sound like the song was out of reach. Barely hit that key.
Stop the love you give may be your own. Take it slow. Some of y'all will be all alone. We're going to 22. I want to be where you are, wherever you is. Project from In Japan, 1973.
Oh,
by Arthur Ross. Leon Ware. Mm-hmm. I want to be where you are, wherever you are.
Can't be, I stayed away too long.
Now, this song he beat up, man.
He beat
this song up.
Yeah, yeah.
He sang this song.
Yeah, he did. He did sing it.
He sang.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, I hear it.
That sound,
I know, but it also Peter Frampton did.
Peter Frampton, yeah, Peter Frampton.
And Jose Feliciano did it.
Jose Feliciano did this.
And actually, I've heard Chaka Khan do this.
Yeah, Chaka did this. She should.
I'm going like, man, because she did the other one, and I'm like, I guess they said you need to do all of Michael's.
Oh, yeah, the proverbial key change. Let's see. We are moving on to I'll Be There Now, first he says, I want to be where you are. Then he's telling some other chick, I'll be there. ABC, Project 97, by Berry Gordy, Bob West, Willie Hutch, Hal Davis.
Now, Mariah should have left this alone.
She did a great job, by the way.
You think so?
She did. It was number one for her.
For her, yeah. That's because she had a whole new audience. But us old folks like, ah.
When I first heard it, I did have a problem with it when I first heard it. And then it sunk into me.
Yeah, it's one of those songs that they flooded the airwaves with.
No, actually, it was a live performance of it that I saw. When she had the guy to step out from a background and do it, when, and the way they played off of each other, to me, he's the one that made it, like, really pop. So I'm like, wow.
Well, the story was, they wasn't, there was no song like that the night before the concert. They just sat around the piano and said, let's just do something. And they started messing around the piano right before the concert. And that became
usually
the number one.
And that's what she did.
She did a much better job than Alicia Keys did on Prince's.
I won't talk about it.
Don't do that.
I won't talk about it.
Don't talk about Alicia Keys in front of Alicia Keys. Don't do it.
But she's cute.
Her name should be Alicia Locke.
Alicia Locke.
Throw the key away.
Bye, Alicia.
That's even better. Alicia off key.
Alicia off key.
That's what Britney did.
Yeah.
Now, I would have rather Janet did it.
What? This song?
This, yes.
Yeah, no. A remake?
Yeah.
Yeah. It would have been a little more sensual, but yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I want her there.
I want
be there, baby.
No.
You don't want Janet there?
No, I don't want to hear Janet try it.
I wouldn't be listening. I'd be watching. Why was she there?
Yeah, that's all right.
Because
after a while, she got old. She started looking too much like Michael.
No, she didn't. I don't know who you looking at.
Oh, yeah. I can go find some pictures, put them side by
that's
side.
That's true. Because people thought they were twins. They thought they were one person. They said,
he
why
was
would
looking
they
like her.
When they did the video together, it looked almost exactly the same. That's before he started pasting out.
Well, that's because he could take his face and put anything on it.
Well, whatever.
You know, he had that Lego face.
Well, they all went to the same plastic surgeon, had the same nose.
24 Brit. They left Indiana, now they're going back. It's from the project called Third Album, 1970. Written by the corporation. Back to Indiana. Indiana. Gary, that is.
They were really just a blues band.
They were a blues band.
Everything they did is blues.
Because
that's
take those old records off the shelf.
That's it.
Yeah.
They were influenced.
Yes, clearly. Well, that's their daddy. I hear her tell that he's not a shabby guitar player himself.
No, he's not.
Okay, Tito, you got it.
All right, Tito.
Ernie Isley, he wasn't.
They give it to Tito and that's all he did?
I like it was the B.B. King.
Oh, I can only hear one ear, so I can't hear it so much because in the other ear.
Oh, you didn't hear
it? I'm saying it. No, he was not an Ernie Isley.
No, he was not. No.
Ernie was like Junior Jimmy.
Junior Jimmy. Jimmy Junior.
Yeah, Jimi Hendrix Jr., man.
We're going back to number 25. That's what we're doing. Got to Be There from the In Japan Project 1973. Yeah, debut studio album Michael Jackson released. This is a Michael Jackson release, y'all, by Motown. The brothers kind of shared in on it, but this is Michael.
I love this song. This is a very beautiful song.
Mm-hmm.
And he had he must have tracked himself, because either they put a some kind of reverb on his mix, so it sounds like he's double.
Yeah. Now they, back then, that's what they did. They doubled voices.
Yes.
And what they would do is not necessarily have you sing again on the top of yourself. What they did was they had you to sing. You sang, and then what they did was they doubled your voice.
You plugged into another track.
Yeah, but then what they did was they backed up the timing just a millisecond. Which made it sound like a double voice.
Wow.
Yes. gave, it's really like it's giving it the echo effect without the echo.
Yeah, this is what Shaka did, and then they wouldn't direct her to do the other one. But she was the only one that had the range to do it.
I learned that from engineering school, y'all, 1994. Gotta Be There is a 1973 project. It includes the song of the same name, which was released on October 7, 1971, as Jackson's debut solo album. It nearly sold 900,000 copies in the U.S. and over 3.2 million copies worldwide. Later remastered, y'all. Mm-hmm. We are doing the Michael Jackson show leading up to the anniversary of his death this month. At the end of the month, we're doing the Michael Jackson show. Don't y'all go nowhere. It's going to be hot and up hopping. Gotta be there for the show, that is. Let's see here. We're going to number 26, y'all. This is Diana Ross presents the Jacksons in 1969. I Want You Back. I Want You Back.
I remember this show.
Mm-hmm. Remember Motown 25th anniversary?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
That's when we first saw the moonwalk.
Well, that's the first time you saw it on TV.
From Michael.
For real.
I saw it on Soul Train when Daniels did it on Soul Train.
Oh, well, I saw it my freshman year of high school in 78.
I saw the Three Stooges do it.
Thank you.
Oh, well, then I saw Crazy Man Jack, what's his name?
He in 1930, yeah.
Yep.
That's right.
It was called the Camel Walk.
Yeah, that's right, the Camel Walk. So, y'all, for a little history, Michael Jackson did not create the moonwalk. I want you back. I want me back. I want some back. Natalie, what you saying? MJ. Yep, MJ. Dr. Albert Addison, what's up, Wall? Baby, shout out to your BOI. Great show. Thank you, Dr. Albert. Man, we miss you on the wall. Come on back and see us sometime, will you please? We're going to number 27. Every time I say goodbye to y'all, I just don't want to say it. But never can say it. Yeah, maybe. Tomorrow album, 1971, by Clifton Davis.
You know, if they could have like mixed this with the one that Isaac Hayes had done. Man, my band teacher did the production on this.
Natalie Bullock, you're late. That's why you ain't hearing the five, because you're late. We played them up there. The song was written and intended for the Supremes to record.
Wow.
However, Motown decided the song would be better for the Jackson 5.
Yeah.
It was the group's most successful song, one of them. Been covered numerous times. Most notable, 1974 disco diva Gloria Gaynor.
Yeah, I remember doing it.
1987 by British pop group The Communards or something. To this spectacular song here, the song which reported sold over 3 million copies, popularized the physically complicated robot dance technique. Devised by Charles Washington in the late 1960s, Michael first performed the dance on television while singing Dancing Machine with the Jackson 5 on an episode of Soul Train. You remember that? Mm-hmm. This is the original LP yeah. version here. G.I.T. Get It Together. 1973 by Hal Davis. Don Fletcher, Dean Parks, the great Dancing Machine.
dancing. They got a video of them doing this with Cher. And Cher actually breaks out and do the dance steps with them and everything. Then she has a dance off with Michael. I was like, wow, I didn't remember Bones moving like that. But hey, but the thing that I kept looking for was to look at Jermaine's fingers to see if he was really playing. Oh, but they still, but he stayed right on with them. Like, wow.
Yeah. Straight gospel.
Yeah. Okay, y'all. I gotta move this train going. This soul train gonna keep it going. Now, this right here is a song originally by a guy named Mick Jackson.
Mick.
Mick. This next song. This next song.
Mick.
He ain't no relative to Michael and those boys.
I thought Emmett Jackson was related.
Yeah, but this is Mick.
It was O. Jackson.
Just like
Mick.
Old, yeah, all Jones Mick. Are related.
Mick O. Jackson.
Yeah, he's a English singer. Yeah. Sound familiar?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Don't blame it on the moonlight.
Yes, sir.
And the sunshine.
Yes, sir.
Blame it on the Sorry, they put a better groove on.
Who? Mick?
They did.
Yes, they did.
They did, because the groove Jackson got his corny.
Yep. Yep. Yeah,
this is more hokey.
This is Blue Eyed Soul right here. Yes, sir. It's a Stevie Wonder voice.
Yeah. It's changed my life completely. I've seen the light delete. This part they play hook. It's like they switch parts.
Mm-hmm.
Of course. Yeah. It's open so you can feel it vibe.
Yes, sir. That's true. Okay. Now y'all be the judge. Yeah, y'all be the judge, and that's Mick Jackson's version. Okay, we're going to Blame It on the Boogie, the Jackson 5 from their Destiny project.
Oh.
Yo, you start getting funky. Yeah. Now. They funky at the intro here.
Yeah.
They use a clavichord chord in there.
Oh, that's what Mike just said.
They picked it up.
Yeah, they picked it up a little bit. That electric keyboard in the back unfortunately soothes it a little bit more. Yeah,
so that was a disco bass.
Yeah,
because you got that look, you got those octaves.
Yeah. This is a 1, 2, 3, 4. Yeah. This is a Quincy Jones mix here in a sort. So he less funkin' did. Yes, we're nerds, y'all. What are you saying, Natalie? What are you doing with this tongue? What are you saying? You gonna give me some Brothers Johnson or did I miss them? Yes, you are very late to the show. Get it, album. Play your air guitar.
What?
Yeah. Okay, then Blame It on the Boogie. I just can't. We're going to another song here. Song written by Gamble and Huff and released 1977. The Jacksons on their CBS debut album. It was only number one song for the group in UK. It was later covered by Danny Minogue. Okay.
I love this song.
Yeah. Show you the way, y'all. Let me show you the way to go.
I remember the album cover being a real simple thing of like just brothers.
You can hear the tease of the Off the Wall coming soon.
Yes.
Yes.
That we can come together and think like one. Come together now. Live together
let me show you.
I remember hearing this song for the first time watching a movie called, remember the movie from the 1970s where the airplane crashed and the people had to live on this ice pack thing in the mountains?
Oh, yeah, that was enough.
And they had to eat each other.
Of, yeah.
Gosh, what's the name of that movie?
That inspired a bunch of them.
Yeah. And I heard this song for the first time. I said, oh my God, what is this? It's so beautiful. So this song anchors me to that movie every time.
Wow.
This is, and maybe some of y'all can find out what movie that was and what year that was. It was a famous.
About like 70.
It kicked off a lot of these. And I think Airplane, yeah. the comedy Airplane was a spoof of it. Yeah.
It was a movie of the week. No, Airplane was a spoof of Airport.
Airport. That's true, Airport.
Right, but this one was like Survival of. It was either ABC or NBC movie of the week.
Yeah.
I want to say Wednesday movie.
This is her here, 32 Brittany. I ain't got about 10 more minutes on Facebook Live before Facebook cut us off. Don't worry, y'all. We'll give y'all the last 5 minutes we got left here. So just enjoy yourself. Song written by Jackson. Single, 1976. Mm-hmm. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy yourself. Enjoy yourself with me. Gambling Huff.
Songs didn't make much sense.
I'm sure it didn't. But you enjoyed it, didn't you?
Yeah, it was all about groove.
That's all it was, the groove.
Woo! What you mean this song didn't make sense? This is perfect sense. This is a cross between Marvin Gaye's Let's Get It On and It's about whole setting up the dance move, the dance groove, so we can get lucky later on.
You crossed this with Marvin Gaye's two songs?
Yeah.
Wow.
It became the group's lyrically, first single to be certified platinum by the RIAA.
Well, I should say, context of the lyrics.
It was also the group's first song to feature new member Randy Jackson, joined the group, y'all, who replaced Jermaine when he decided to stay at Motown after his brother left. His brother, as y'all know, married old Berry Gordy's daughter. And Berry Gordy felt kind of bad for him because he didn't have no hits. So they began to give him, Stevie Wonder began to write for Jermaine.
Let's Get Out Tonight.
Yes, sir. It also features backing vocals from Janet and LaToya.
Why don't you do what you do?
Yeah. It was sampled on the Backstreet Boys project.
Enjoy yourself.
This church right here.
Yes, church.
Yeah. We're going to number 33. We're almost there, y'all. 33, 34, 35, 36. We got about 4 more to go. Can you feel it? Can you feel it?
Yeah, I play this in both.
Can you feel it? Many bands do this song. Marching bands? My gosh, today. Shout out to Bethune Cookman, my alma mater.
This premiered on American Bandstand.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Recorded in March 1980. Dick Clark put it out there.
Yes.
From the Triumph Project.
Big ol' ass.
And this is where, and then Dick also gave Mike a lot of accolades. It's like, and Michael has a lot to do with the visuals and this, that, and other. And this is when he started to break out into his own little thing.
Yes, sir. Written by Michael and Jackie, by the way. Randy is leading.
Yep.
Greg filling games on keyboard. Ronnie Foster guitar. Tito Jackson on the guitar.
Oh man, this is straight up marching band song.
Yep.
This is maybe.
Can you feel it? Guitar right here. My favorite part right there. Again, you hear
Mike.
His finger.
His progression.
The
music. You're gonna hear these in his song.
You're gonna hear it on the Thriller. Coming up, which is only maybe a couple.
You don't have this hotel on here,
huh?
Heartbreak Hotel.
Is that what you want? Y'all get on my nerves. 35, Brittany.
This was a hit. Mike wrote this. If he didn't write that,
this is called This Place.
This Place, yeah. This
Hotel,
place.
AKA Hotel. Heartbreak. Originally named Heartbreak.
Oh, man.
This was the beginning of the dramatics.
Yes. Written by Michael, produced by the Jacksons. It will precede Jackson's own hit, Billie Jean. Yes. In its insecurity-plagued tale of confusion.
We
did Vincent Price voice. Go out there. Do it.
You know what I'm saying? His brothers did not sing background vocals.
They were
credited with playing percussions on the album, while Tito contributed the guitar solo. The song has a tempo.
This album also had Time Waits for No One that came up right after this. That you'd only hear in the wee hours of the night on the radio.
Yes, sir. The song has a tempo of 98 beats per minute, making it notably slower than many of the disco-based songs of the album.
This is a bad song.
Yes, sir.
Beginning of his doing this R his own. This came after Off the Wall.
And it's 1980.
Oh no, okay, it's right before Off the Wall. This is leading up to Off the
Wall. Right, this is just before he's about to he's gonna do one more with the Glitter Pants, and then he's gonna step off into the Penny Loafers and the Flood.
Penny Loafers and Flood.
That's what I thought. This did come after Off the Wall.
Yeah, I don't know what y'all saying. Off the Wall came on in 1970.
So you hear the beginning of this. This probably should have been
this
off
was like
the wall.
Last. This was like the last one of the last things he did with the brothers.
Well, he has two more.
And we're gonna fix that in about 3 weeks when we do Michael Jackson Project show. But we're going to 34, Brittany. Since they're skipping on me, this one right here is Down to the Ground. You know what Down to the Ground is?
Falling.
Nope. Shake Your Body. Down to the Ground.
This is another one that probably would have been off the wall.
On the Destiny Project. Peaked at number 7 on the Billboard Hot 100, May 1979.
Yep, this would have been off the wall. He probably picked the stuff that didn't make off the wall. They just put on it now.
Yes, sir. The chorus, Let's Dance, Let's Shout, Shake Your Body Down to the Ground, was inspired by an ad-lib from Marvin Gaye's Got to Give It Up. Now you know.
See, that was like great music for marching band days.
Yes, sir.
Like you had one just jamming
on. Great marching band music. You guys are working those invisible instruments, walking on drums, having on boards and guitar. We the baddest Arab musicians in the world. Brittany, I want to go to 36 right quick because Mick Jagger wanted a piece of the Michael and his brothers. So they got together, sat down in 1984 and decided to do a little project called State of Shock. My Sharona.
Yeah, my Sharona, man.
But that was like, there's a couple of cards cut you can like throw in there also.
Mm-hmm.
That was kind of like the whole feel.
That's typical 80s rock pop mix.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Because I gotta say, Mick Jagger's when Keith Richards was doing all the music. But,
yeah. You know what I'm saying?
And then, you know, when Mick comes over and everything, I go down to the basement, play a little on the keys and play.
State of shock. Last song of the night, y'all. This is the first time in maybe since I've been doing Faithful Live that it actually didn't cut me off. But y'all about to get cut off. It's got like 30 seconds. But the last song of the night is The Jacksons, 2300 Jackson Street. It features in the video Austin Brown, Autumn Joy Jackson, Brandy Jackson, Jamie Jackson, Jackie Jackson, Janet, Jeremy, Jermaine, Joe, Jordine, Catherine Jackson, Marlon Jackson, Michael, Randy, Reeby, Sigmund, Stacy Brown, Tito Jackson, Todd Jackson, TJ, Terrell Jackson, Yashi Brown.
But you didn't have to call me Jackson.
Oh, you hear the sax. What were they doing the sound altos back then to get that sound? Oh, I know that, but I'm like... Then Michael got his revenge on Joe later.
What'd he do?
Oh man, when he did that interview with whatever it was.
Oh, when he lied about only having two surgeries.
Well, yeah. After he had already admitted to Barbara Walters, one of the other ones. He started painting Joe as the horrible taskmaster.
Eve Cook said, and Jesse Jack.
That's good, Eve.
This is, you know what this is? Commission.
Yes. Number 6 album.
Yeah. 1989 single released by the Jacksons from their album of the same name. The song featured Michael and Marlon, who had previously left the group. Although this is the only track that they are featured on the album, it also features two of the Jackson sisters, Reeby and Janet. It's about the Jackson family's childhood home in Gary, Indiana. The track was written and composed by the Jacksons as well as Teddy Riley, among others.
That explains the mix.
Absolutely. The video features most of the Jackson families, including children of the Jacksons. LaToya is not featured in the music video, nor the song, as she was estranged from the family at the time.
Oh, I also remember she did Playboy.
Marlon, while he sang on the track, also didn't appear in the video. Some scenes include the Jackson family playing pool and Jermaine, Tito, Randy, and Jackie playing football. It also shows some members of the Jackson family, apart from LaToya and Marlon, singing the song together. The video was shot in March 1989. Alvin, what were you doing in 1989?
I was in college.
Yeah? Oh, wow.
Trying to develop and expand my music career.
Okay. You trying to be Jackson part Deuce?
No, I ain't want to be no Jackson.
No.
I mean, I could take some Jackson money, but I didn't want to have no Jackson drama.
Well, you got two
except
kids.
Except Janet. Janet or Reeby. Janet or Reeby, fine. Both of them fine.
Yeah, they are.
Because what people don't realize, Reeby was a great singer, had a good album.
Yeah. She did have great
album. Centipede was a good album. The problem was it was ahead of its time.
Right.
Because Mike said, okay. And each one of them songs, except for Centipede, he put on one of his albums.
That's true.
I still listen to Centipede.
Of course you do.
Missing the P.
Yep. Yeah, I love that album.
And I still play Centipede, the video game.
That's a fun game, too.
It is a great game.
But the video, yeah, I mean, that girl could move, too. Now, if they had been smart, when them was leaving the group, they'd have incorporated the women of the group that could sing.
Yeah. So that means Janet wouldn't have been there.
Well, you're trying to say Janet's not a woman?
No, she just wasn't a singer.
She learned later.
Yeah, she did learn later.
And that's my point.
Because I remember, you remember the soundtrack?
Young Love?
No, Beach Street.
Beach Street.
Beach Street.
And then they tried to put her on Fame, and no.
No, she wasn't. That was Joe trying to get her famous as an actress, because that was her claim to fame.
Yeah, but that wasn't working.
Well, she did all right as an actress, too.
But that wasn't working. Not on Fame.
Oh, not Fame.
When everybody else could sing and dance, including the ones that could be a comedian.
You can't do that. You can't do that.
But then Terry Lewis then got a hold of her.
I remember when they came to Chicago at the White Sox Theater. I'm sorry, the White Sox Ballpark.
Okay.
Theater.
Yeah.
They came here because they were getting ready to tear down White Sox, Comiskey Park.
Yes.
Right.
And they came here and did their farewell concert.
At Comiskey.
And the Dan Ryan was amazing.
It was a mess. Jammed and jacked.
Yeah. I saw it on TV because at that time I was in school. I was down in Dumfries County.
Actually made a nice some money off of that too.
You did?
Yeah. I was at Russian T-shirts.
I think that was the victory tour. Wasn't it the victory tour?
Yeah, it was a victory tour.
Oh boy.
And I had this one shirt that I did where it was from Michael Jackson Thriller, where you saw him go from the werewolf back to regular Michael to the zombie. And I sold it. Should have sold it for more. But anyway. So if anyone out there listening, you have my shirt.
Yeah. The 1980s the
you only made one.
Yeah, that's all I had time for.
No, you're supposed to print it.
The printing system back then as silk screen was not comparable to the way you know of airbrushing.
Do it again. I bet you sell it.
Oh, I bet you. I can do iron-ons now.
You should have been doing that stuff back then when he died.
Do you remember?
Man, I sold somebody some baby shoes and said I got them from Gary, Indiana, where the house was. Don't you see the JJ on it, MJ and stuff?
Oh, Lord. These were Joe Jackson shoes.
Actually, it had a bunch of letters on it. First, it said S. Jackson.
Fort Sheridan, then.
They kept crossing them up.
Oh, Fort Sheridan.
She said you were living at Fort Sheridan then. We don't call it Fort Sheridan anymore.
Not anymore since it's closed down. But back in the day, that was the spot to get to.
Fort Sheridan.
The fort on the lake, it was like, you know, military condos.
Yeah. Reginald McDonald's. Hey, man. Where you been? You ain't been on the show since you been on the show last time. What's up, Adam Sakata? I remember old Comiskey watched the Sox there. Yeah, that's right, man. Yeah. What is it now? Something Field?
It's U.S. Cellular, which doesn't exist in Chicago anymore.
Right. It doesn't exist in Chicago.
Doesn't exist.
No.
Right.
The service, the carrier does, but they don't exist
here. U.S. Cellular still?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Well, I found out when I took my daughter to school because they have U.S. Cellular.
There, not here.
Theater. Like we have United. They're United Center there.
Top of Wisconsin, somewhere like
that. Well, I don't know.
But you're saying the service is not.
Yeah, it's not here.
Right.
It's not here in Chicago, but there is service.
Yes, there's service in other states.
Okay, no.
Because they have a big, like our United Center.
Sure.
They have U.S. Cellular Center in Cedar Rapids, Iowa. Huge arena.
Wow, didn't know that.
Yep.
Did not know that. Yeah, because they're trying to do naming rights now for the John Hancock. And, of course, they're trying to rename, of course, what is it, Willis? Is it Willis?
Well, they've already renamed the Sears Tower as Willis Tower, but true Chicagoans won't call it the Willis Tower.
No, I mean, they're gonna name it again because
Willis sold it.
Yeah, some Brits bought it, and they want to call
it. Well, Willis are Brits.
I know, but there was Willis some other joint.
Well, who
they
else
are they want to call it the Queen Marianne, the Queen Marianne. The Blase, Skippy, and the Woo.
Yeah, naming rights is something else. Because when Macy's did their little thing, I was very, very highly upset about that.
Oh, yeah, Marsha Field.
You know, just ridiculous. I hated it. Why can't you just leave well enough alone? All right?
Because when they buy you, they buy your name, they destroy your name, they want to eliminate it. It's all ego.
Slavery.
Yeah.
That's all it is. It's slavery. Because the man took you from your land. And then
so you changed your name, too.
Yeah, you changed your name.
What's your name? Well, it was Johnson, but now owned by Master Bill, so my name is Johnson Bills. That's how that's where hyphenated names come from,
That's
y'all.
What come from. Yeah. Look at the three Hebrew boys.
Yeah.
Their names will change once they got into captivity.
That's right.
Yes, sir. That's what it is. That's just the way it is, y'all. Y'all's name is changed. Alvin
Meshach,
Alvin.
Meshach, and somebody goes.
Yeah. The Rise of Jackson 5. What album? I mean, who said that? You?
What?
The rise of Jackson 5 in the 1960s and 70s coincided with the rise of a very similar musical group, the Osmonds.
Yeah.
The Osmonds had risen to fame as a regular performer on the Andy Williams show. Jay Osmond would later note Michael had a unique sense of humor about him and told us he was so tired of watching the Osmonds on the Andy Williams show. He explained this was something their father had them do. And Michael joked he became really tired of it. The song One Bad Apple written by George Jackson, who had the five in mind when he wrote it, was originally presented to Motown Records chairman of the board, Berry Gordy, for the group to record, but he turned it down. He was then presented to MGM Records for the Osmonds.
And he took it.
One Bad Apple, which the Osmonds recorded in a similar style to the song of the Jackson 5 at the time, reached number one and began a string of several hits for the Osmonds. Both bands followed a similar career trajectory, a string of several hits as a group, which eventually led to a breakout star, Michael for the Jacksons and Donnie for the Osmonds. Becoming a solo artist, a little sister not originally part of the group, also rising to fame, Janet and Marie Osmond, respectively, and eventually declined as a smaller group in the 1980s. The two groups' members eventually became friends, despite public perception of a rivalry between the two and allegations that the Osmonds, white Mormon brothers from Utah, were an imitation of the Black Jackson 5. Now, this story is still...
Jehovah's Witnesses?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Mm-hmm. But this story is exactly alike as American Bandstand and Soul Train.
Yes.
Yes. Because many people don't know that it was American Bandstand's, what's his name?
Dick Clark.
Dick Clark, who wanted to shut down Soul Train.
Oh, yeah. He wanted to stop it.
Yeah. He wanted to shut it down until he was doing some things in the music business to kind of shut it down. Because...
it was competition.
Mr. Soul Man talked about it on...
Don Cornelius talked about it on an interview.
On his interview. Yeah.
But he was saying he picked up a lot of momentum because no one had any faith in it. Mm-hmm. That's why he wound up having so much of the property owning. Because when he was at Channel 26, I remember when he was on Channel 26.
26,
yes. Yeah.
All right. I remember that very vividly because my older brother managed to get on the show one time. And then when he left to go to California... there was still a case of it'll never do anything, but it's at the point to when it seemed like it was, well, at the point when it was on the rise and starting to blow up is when he started to run into obstacles.
Well, yeah.
But it was too late.
And plus, he was limited to soul and funk, and he didn't want to move into the disco era, which was very popular then.
And he hated disco.
He hated disco, and so what he did, he was a businessman. He began to create Shalimar. He used the dancers. Who was it? Jody Watley.
What's his face?
Yeah.
And then he hired Howard. Later.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And
Daniels, the boy Daniels.
Sure.
And then.
Yeah. Yeah. So that group was invented by the man himself. And then he says, you know what? This might be working because people are watching this disco thing.
And that girl with that hair.
Mm-hmm. He says, we might have to do something with this. Now, of course, by the time he invented them, disco was on his way out.
It was short-lived
because
it was too fast of a lifestyle.
And speak of Comiskey Park, that's where it ended, right here. They burnt.
Yep.
They who was it?
Steve Dahl from the Loop. I remember
Steve Dahl, man.
Disco Suck. He even had a song called Disco Suck because he had a group called Teenage Radiation that he was trying to push really hard.
Yeah.
And they would do all kinds of anti-disco songs, and everybody joined in the bandwagon.
They did.
And they blew up a few disco albums.
Tore up Comiskey Park. Yeah, had
Bill Vett was like,
yeah,
let's do it. Yeah, bring on in there. Yeah.
And destroyed disco.
Actually, disco lasted longer in the 90s than it did in the 70s.
And but see, now over here, disco is it's hidden.
Yeah.
It's house music. It was house music, then became techno. There's another one.
Actually, I like it.
There's
techno.
Underground. Let me go to my list of
genres.
Of genres, and yeah, I'll tell y'all what disco is because over in Europe it's huge.
Oh, it never died over there.
Never died.
Actually, KC from the KC and the Sunshine Band talked about like when it died here, it kept going there.
Yes, sir.
Because he said, but you know, like in Japan, it was like you could see an individual walk out of a classical concert hall and walk straight into a discotheque.
Yes, sir.
And like they had appreciation, then they would leave there and go to a blues club.
Well, let me show you here.
And show up at a gospel concert.
Here is.
I say only here in the States, like, oh, you have to be restricted to one genre.
Yes.
You have what's called an electronic genre.
Right.
Okay, electronic genre. And here are the genres within that. Reginald, were you saying, when is your music segment coming up? Play some of this history. What are you saying?
I don't know.
Music segment? I don't understand. I don't understand that question. Electronic, two-step, okay, they call, now these are names that we don't know nothing about because the young folk are taking it, I guess. aka 8-bit, bit pop, and chiptune. You got ambient, bassline, chip, let's see, crunk.
Oh, I've heard of crunk.
Down tempo.
Oh, yeah, crunk is, yeah.
Drum and bass, electro. Electro swing. Mm-hmm. Yes. Electronica. Electronic rock. Hard style. IDM. Experimental. I think it was called industrial. Trip hop. Thanks to Mike. And they're giving names to the people who created this. Then let's see. You got German folk. German, let's see. And now I'm looking for where. What did they put disco under? Let's see. Hip hop got a whole bunch of them up under it, from gangster to West Coast to underground. Let's see, indie, inspirational, instrumental. Let's see, jazz. Let's see, karaoke, Latin, New Age, pop, R&B, reggae, rock.
It's not in alphabetical order.
It's in alphabetical order. Well, we passed disco, but they may not call it that. Well, Tex-Mex. That's Chicano.
Ooh.
And that's a name you don't use. I'm surprised they even call it Chicano, because that's a derogatory.
Right.
Let's see. Well, world, I get that. And sometimes it is hidden under world music, though. Let's see. Middle Eastern, traditional. Yeah, that's... they don't give disco its own for some reason. Let's see. La ta da ta tee dee tee. Disney got his own. Ain't that something?
Yeah, they got so many songs.
Yeah. Okay. Dance. Mm-hmm. Let's go to dance. Because, yeah, I bet you that's where it is.
Yep.
EDM, electric dance music. Club dance. Breakcore. Breakbeat, bro step, chill step, deep house, dubstep, which is very popular now, electro house, exercise, future garage, glitch hop, grime, hardcore, hard dance, horrorcore, and house is in there, of course, jackin' house. Who did they give that to? Thanks to Jermaine, Benjamin, Dale, Bruce. We have here, what, Farley Funk?
Farley Jack Master Funk.
Jack, and somebody
rest
else.
In peace. All of the Hot Mix 5 DJs.
Hot Mix 5, yeah. Reginald, you know these names. Y'all help me out with these names of disco was its own genre, he's saying. Right, it is. But for some reason, they don't have disco in it. It was. I guess that's why they put it under someone else now, and they disguise it. They don't call it that anymore. Cause the, let's see, Jack House, Jungle or Drum and Bass, Liquid Dub, Reg Step, Speed Core, of course Techno, Trance, and then Trap. These are names you're beginning to hear more and more, and all of it is disco.
Yes,
just sped up or slowed down.
It's born out of disco.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, born out of it. And many of these genres, these subgenres, are born out of something else, and they just put another name on it.
I like rock and roll, born out of blues.
You're right. Yes. You're right. Rock and roll is born out of blues.
It'll speed it up a bit.
That's so true.
And you see more, and it's more mm-hmm. evident in like the groups mm-hmm. from the 60s.
Yes.
You like the Rolling Stones, Led Zeppelin. If you really stop and like tone down the distortion from the guitar, you'll hear straight blues riding from yeah. under it.
Yeah, you're right. And if you play what we call shout music in church, mm-hmm. that's rock and roll.
You
that's
rock and roll?
That's yes, that's rock and roll. That's grunge. That's hard rock. If you listen to a
how hard is jazz?
Yeah, well, yeah, but they all similar to each other.
Right.
They're synonymous.
You know,
but that's
running into
but
the jazz.
That's straight rock.
When you start getting complex with it,
because
of
the repeat,
jazz.
Because jazz has more of a it has more of a it changes.
Right.
The turnaround more it changes, but rock just
right.
a
straight head drive.
Yeah, straight drive. So under rock they got acid rock, adult oriented, Afro punk, adult alternative rock, American trad. Grunge. Anatolian rock, arena rock, art rock. That's you, Art.
blues, yes, I do.
Mm-hmm. Blues rock, British invasion, cock rock, shut up, Alvin. Death metal, black metal. Doom metal, glam rock, gothic metal, grindcore, hair glam metal.
Yeah, that's one that's going on big core? Over in grind? Europe.
Which hard rock, math metal. That's for, I guess, for the intelligent kids, I guess. I don't know. Math rock, metal, metalcore, they noise rock.
They do a lot of changes in them.
Well,
math.
Isn't all of it noise? Then it's noise rock, really? Jam bands, post-punk, prog rock. Fraggle rock, no.
Cute.
Yeah, progressive metal, psychedelic, that's an old one. Rock and, yeah, rock and roll, really.
And the God of the Vita.
Rockabilly, that's for the hillbillies, I guess.
No, that's Bill Haley in the
NASCAR,
comics.
NASCAR, yeah. Mark Murdoch, okay. Roots, singer-songwriter. Now, I love singer-songwriter. You got to go to 1970s really to understand that whole era. Southern rock, spaz core, stoner metal.
Sorry. So we got lost here because we're talking about brothers and now we're in the rock.
Yep. Technical, I got time because the show's over.
Oh.
Technical death metal, Tex-Mex, Time Lord, trash metal.
Rock and roll
metal.
With a tuba.
Brittany, get me out of here. That's right, Reginald McDonald. You shout off of rock, and the people don't even realize it. We've been shouting off of rock for a long time.
Well, we'd be rocking and clapping.
We'd be rocking and clapping. Mm-hmm. This is a great song by the Jackson 5 called We're Here to Entertain You. That's exactly why many of us are doing our shows. It's on the Joyful Jukebox Music Boogie, 1976. Y'all may never have heard this song before. So those of you who go on Spreaker.com, you'll hear. I'll rewind it for you so you can hear it in its entirety. Just a great little ditty here. So soft and serene. We're here to entertain you. That's what the Jackie 5 was trying to tell you. That's all we did for you, just entertain you. And y'all created some monsters. Yes, you did. Tomorrow, Theology Thursday, Elder Ryan Jones will be here, and we'll be talking about the proper way to forgive. Proper way to forgive. Go to Spreaker.com and hear the show in stereophonics. I would like to apologize to President Barack Obama and Michelle. We didn't get a chance to interview you.
Next time, just walk in the room. Okay? Yeah, next don't time. Stand out there no more. Yeah, just walk
just,
on in
just here. Come on in, President Barack Obama. Just
let,
come on in.
You let
Art get
right past you.
And we'll get you in here tomorrow, okay? I guarantee that. Brittany, thank you for spinning the wax. We got Brittany with us for another, what, two more days? And she gone. Thursday and Friday's, the last day, y'all. So let's thank the good Lord. And this tea that I'm drinking, that the great Brittany Monique was with us. My gosh, I don't know what I'm going to do today. I don't know what I'm going to do Friday, but I'm going to do something to figure out how I'm going to not cry on the air. Tony Young says,
oh, she's leaving us. Who's going to be sarcastic and satirical
know.
And be our human?
I really don't know.
Database.
You says that seems praise and worship is trying to cross over. I watch God is Not Dead and Newsboys, and Israel Houlton is doing a lot of crossover music. Psh, man, Tony. That's been going on a long time.
Long time.
Long, very, long, very long time. It's called CCM. We'll talk about that later on, though. Mm-hmm. Okay, y'all. Gotta go. Thank you, Art Lewis. And Alvin, you're doing the best you can.
Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord. Help
yeah.
me, Lord.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Pray for those who got shot today. Two dead. I know we didn't do the news, man. But over there at the college, you know, what's the college over there? UCLA.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, pray for the families who got shot over there. Yeah, universities are under attack. You got just one
so
crazy fool
from Virginia Tech, UCLA. Mm-hmm.
Yep, that's what they do. That's what they do. Hey, y'all, share it with your friends. Black Father's Day Challenge. Post on Facebook positive things about black men all month long, and watch how the brothers change. Gotta go, y'all. So, Father Jones Show.
Hey, ladies and gents, if you missed any of today's show, head to Spreaker.com and search the Sir Walter Jones Show and listen to this show and past shows. Now remember, search for the Sir Walter Jones Show on Spreaker.com. That's Spreaker spelled S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. And enjoy.
You have been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show, where Sir Walter Jones provides you with a biblical perspective on everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones at his website, www.sirwalterjones.com. Search the Sir Walter Jones Show on Facebook or follow on Twitter at Sir Walter's Music. Until next time, thank you for listening to the Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.
Thank you, Mr. Walters.